गुरवे गौरचंद्राय राधिकायै तदालये कृष्णाय कृष्णभक्ताय तद्भक्ताय नमो नमः। वंदे गुरुन ईशभक्तान ईशम ईशावतारकान तत्प्रकाशांश तच्छक्तिम कृष्णचैतन्यसम्यकम् आनंदलीलामय विग्रहाय हेमावदिव्यच्छविसुंदराय तस्मै महाप्रेमरसप्रदाय चैतन्यचंद्राय नमो नमस्ते। चैतन्यचंद्राय नमो नमस्ते। चैतन्यचंद्राय नमो नमस्ते। श्री चैतन्यचंद्राय नमो नमस्ते। नित्यानंदम अहम नौमि सर्वानंदकरं परं हरिनामप्रदं देवं अवधूतशिरोमणिं। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभो नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवास आदि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। So my prostrated obeisances to all the wonderful Vaishnavas and Vaishnavis joining for this discussion. My spiritual master Srila Radha Govinda Maharaj instructed me that before Harikatha I must bow down and sincerely seek the blessings and the heartfelt best wishes and prayers of all the assembled Vaishnavas and Vaishnavis. Srila Guru Maharaj once told me that you don't know anything, but if you take the foot dust of all the assembled Vaishnavas and pray for them and for their blessings and prayers, then you will be able to speak in line with the parampara. So taking the instruction of my spiritual master on my head, I bow down to each one of you one after another individually. Please kindly pray for me. Please offer your blessings and heartfelt best wishes so that the right words come at the right time in the right spirit, glorifying the most merciful, wonderfully magnanimous, wonderfully merciful, the most beautiful, attractive incarnation, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. May this narration bring complete satisfaction to the ears of all the assembled devotees, and may this endeavor cleanse my heart as the speaker in this process. Vancha kalpataru bhyascha kripa sindhu bhya evacha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha. So I really want to thank each one of you for kindly participating. This is the 28th of February 2019, and this is the first session number one on our series of Gaur Leela Katha building up to Gaur Purnima 2019. So we want to discuss different aspects of Gaur Avatar during these days, and every day we will take an hour long discussion. So today, since it's an introduction to our seminar, we will talk about Gaura Tattva. We will discuss briefly about Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's philosophical, transcendental, spiritual, theological identity. We have heard so many times that Sri Krishna Chaitanya Radhar Krishna Nahi Anya, that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is non-different from Radha and Krishna. But still, when we stand in front of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Sri Nityananda Prabhu in the form of their deities and we bow down, are we completely convinced about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's identity? Are we completely 100% sure that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is not another mere mortal, or Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is not a self-styled Godman, or Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was actually having ecstatic symptoms because he was a great devotee but not God? Do we have all these doubts? Do we think really that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Radha and Krishna? In fact, interestingly, in the Navadvip Dham Mahatmya, Bhakti Vinod Thakur, he explains that Lord Shiva in Kailash, who is a dear devotee of Sri Krishna as Gopeshwar Mahadev, and dear associate of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as Sri Advaita Acharya, that Sadashiva, he holds a trident, he holds a trishul, has very sharp three spikes, and Thakur Bhaktivinoda explains that those three spikes, sharp edges of that trident, are meant for specific purposes. The first sharp edge of the trident is to poke and chase after those personalities who doubt the truth of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's identity. Those who are not convinced that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is actually Radha and Krishna, to chase after them, the first sharp edge, the first spike of the trident is kept. Now, what is the second one kept for? It is kept for those who are convinced that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Radha and Krishna, but are not convinced in the first place that Krishna is Bhagavan. And therefore, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is also not Sri Krishna. This is what the doubt is about. So the first spike of the trident is meant for those who think that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu may or may be Radha Krishna, not sure. Those who doubt, the first spike of the trident is meant for them. The second is meant for those who are convinced that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Radha Krishna, but doubt the transcendental identity of Krishna in the first place, and hence therefore are not convinced that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is God. And the third and the final sharp edge is meant for those who are convinced that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Krishna, taking the mood of Radharani, and who are convinced that Krishna is God and hence Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is God, but are not convinced enough that Navadvip Dham is as identical to Vrindavan as proclaimed in the scriptures. So those who say Navadvip Dham and Vrindavan Dham are two different abodes, the scriptures actually have an over-exaggeration to say that Navadvip Dham is philosophically same as Vrindavan Dham. Those who doubt this, the third and the final edge of the trident is meant for them. So every time we see Lord Shiva with a trident, we have to ask ourselves these three questions. Am I completely convinced that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Radha and Krishna? Radha Krishna Swarup, Abhinna Swarup, non-different Murti in Kali. Second, am I completely convinced that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the Supreme Personality of Godhead in His most perfected form, complete form? And third question, am I completely convinced that Navadvip Dham and Sri Vrindavan Dham are exactly identical? So therefore, we have these classes leading up to Gaur Purnima, so that we as Gaudiyas, who proclaim ourselves to be the follower of the six Goswamis of Vrindavan, who are the direct followers of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, so that we can do justice to our name, that we are followers of Gauranga Mahaprabhu. Who is Gauranga Mahaprabhu? And why should we follow him? All of these things. So today, as we begin, we want to start from the basic, fundamental, rudimentary blocks of the puzzle. In the Bhagavad Gita, our most wonderfully attractive and beautiful Sri Krishna, He has given three reasons why He appears. And as we famously know, Krishna explains in the Gita, Paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha dushkritam dharma samsthapanarthaya sambhavami yuge yuge. That paritranaya sadhunam, paritrana means to protect. Sadhunam, the pure devotees. Vinashaya cha dushkritam, dushkriti, just like Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, na mam dushkriti no moodha prapadhyante naradhama mayaya aparita jnana asuram bhavamashrita. Dushkriti, kriti, krita means activity. Good activities are called sukriti. Sukrit, And bad activities are called duhkrit or dushkrit. So Krishna says, paritranaya sadhunam, to protect the pure devotees, and vinashaya. Nasha means destruction. Krishna doesn't say just nasha, I come to destroy. He says vinasha. V means vishesha rupena. Oh, with a very special gift. Nasha. I come to destroy them, but in a very special way. Meaning, I kill them, but then also liberate them. So it's not just coming to kill them. I kill them and liberate them. So that liberation or entrance into the eternal abode of the Lord is V. V means Vishesh, very special. So Krishna comes to destroy the demons and liberate them. And he comes to protect the pure devotees. So the interesting question is, who is a sadhu? Sadhu is he who's already protected. He who's not under the modes of material nature and who's completely protected by his devotional practice and by the mercy of Hari, Guru and Vaishnava in his perfected stage is called sadhu. So if someone needs protection, he is not sadhu. And only when one is completely protected is one called sadhu. So sadhu is always protected, and he who is not protected is not called sadhu. Right? So Krishna says, I come to protect the sadhus. Why would Krishna make such a statement? Protection is needed for those who are not sadhus. For sadhus are protected. They don't need protection. Chanting the holy name protects the sadhu. Prahlad Maharaj would chant the holy name and he would get protected from being completely boiled in the pot of oil, hot oil. He would chant the holy name and that would, the chanting of the holy name would protect him while he would be under the lotus feet of all those big, gigantic, humongous elephant. When he was thrown in the pit of very dangerous black cobra snakes, just chanting the holy name would attract the snakes and hypnotize and force them in surrendering to Sri Prahlad Maharaj's lotus feet. Even when he was thrown from top of the cliff, chanting the holy name protected him. So those who are sadhus, they are protected by the holy name. So Krishna should actually say that I come to protect those who are not sadhus. But then why is he saying I come to protect those who are sadhus, who are already protected? Oh, this is a very deep verse. Sadhus who are protected from material nature, when they are performing Hari Bhajan, when they are chanting the holy name and hearing about Krishna, chanting the movement of their lips and movement of their tongue, that movement creates friction to ignite the fire of separation in the heart from the Lord. You see, in this world, when you rub stones, you can ignite fire. So by the friction of two similar substances, you can ignite fire, specifically forest stones. So similarly, when the lips, the tongue, the teeth all move together with the desire to serve the Lord, that friction of the chanting of the holy name ignites the fire of separation in the heart. And such a pure devotee cries in separation. When can I see Krishna? When can I see Krishna?
Eka kale kotha gela gora nataraj.
Narottam Das Thakur is saying, Eka kale kotha gela. Oh, where did my Shachinandan Gaura Hari, who is the embodiment of all transcendental qualities, the ecstatic dancer, where did he go?
Pashane kuthibo matha anale pashibo. Gauranga gunera nidhi kotha gele pavo.
Srila Narottam Das Thakur says, without Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, pashane kuthibo matha, I am ready to actually smash my skull into pieces, and anale pashibo, and I am ready to enter burning forest fire. Gauranga gunera nidhi, that Gauranga Mahaprabhu, who is a treasure of all transcendental qualities, kotha gele, oh, where did he go? So which means Narottam Das Thakur is burning in the fire of separation, and to save the sadhu from the fire of separation, the Supreme Lord appears. So, Sambhavami Yuge Yuge, I appear yuga after yuga, because in every yuga there are pure sadhus who are burning in the fire of separation, and to save those sadhus from the fire of their separation, the Lord appears. Dharma samsthapanarthaya. Then the Lord comes to lift scriptural, spiritual principles. It's so fascinating that when Krishna and Balaram, they go to Mathura on the pretext of the bow sacrifice, Kamsa Maharaj has sent Akrura to get Krishna and Balaram out of Vrindavan into Mathura so that they can be killed under the feet of the mad elephant Kuvalayapida. And if they escape from him, then they have Chanur and Mushtik to slam Krishna and Balaram to death. And if that doesn't work, then Kamsa Maharaj himself, who can lift Kailas, who's so powerful. Kamsa Maharaj had the power of 10,000 mad elephants in each of his arms. He was ready to slam Krishna and Balaram to death. So this was the purpose. But to sugarcoat it, he, on the pretext of the bow sacrifice, got Krishna and Balaram there. And Krishna and Balaram lifted the bow. They lifted the bow and broke the bow, and carrying the bow pieces in their hand, they were walking. To which our acharyas comment a very beautiful, sweet point. They say the word bow in Sanskrit can also be translated as dharma. So dharma generally means spiritual principles, but even a bow in Sanskrit can be translated, according to the Amarkosh, the word dictionary, as dharma. So therefore the acharyas comment, why were Krishna and Balaram able to lift the bow, break the bow and carry the bow in their hands? Because the bow can also be called as dharma, and the only personalities who can lift dharma when it falls down is Guru and Krishna. Guru represented by Balaram, and Krishna represents Bhagavat Tattva. Not just that, Krishna can also break the bow, which means he can also break externally, quote unquote, from this social viewpoint, he also may seem sometimes to break dharmic principles, although it doesn't happen so. So he can lift dharmic principles, he can break them, and he can walk with them also in his hand. So to represent this point, Krishna and Balaram, they lifted the bow, broke the bow and walked with it. So therefore, dharma samsthapanarthaya, Krishna comes to uplift dharma or spiritual principles. But interestingly, to protect the sadhus, Krishna doesn't have to come. As mentioned previously, the holy name of Krishna is enough. To destroy the demons, Krishna doesn't have to come, because Mother Nature is enough through natural calamities to destroy all the Ravanas and Kumbhakarnas. And to protect the devotees, Krishna doesn't have to come. Or let's say, to uplift dharma, Krishna doesn't have to come, because pure devotees like Srila Prabhupada can be sent on the planet and they can push Kali by another 5,000 years by their presence. So Krishna actually doesn't have to come in this world to protect the devotees, to destroy the demons, or to uplift and re-establish dharmic principles. Because protection is given by the holy name, destruction of the demons is done by Mother Nature, and dharma samsthapanarthaya, the samsthapana, the re-establishment of scriptural, spiritual, pristine, pure, eternal principles can be done by pure Vaishnavas. Janasya Krishna Vimukasya Daivat Adharma Shila Sudukhitasya Anugrahaye Hacharanti Nunam Bhutani Bhavyani Janardhanasya. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 3, Chapter 5, Text 3 explains, Janasya Krishnad Vimukhasya Daivat. Oh, those who are Vimukha, they are facing away from Krishna. What happens to them? Adharma. Oh, they become irreligious. And therefore, Sudukhitasya, become utterly miserable.
And to save such personalities, anugrahayeha charanti nunam. Pure devotees walk in this world to save these personalities from their suffering by forcibly turning their face towards Sri Krishna's moonlight beautiful face. Therefore, bhutani bhavyani janardhanasya. Such pure devotees who spread walking around this world giving Krishna to everyone, they are bhavyani. They are big pots of mercy that Krishna sends in this world. So why does Krishna come down? If dharma can be re-established by pure devotees through their preaching, and protection can be given by the holy name, and destruction can be done by Mother Nature, why does he come down? Oh, this is answered by Brahmaji in Brahma Stuti, Canto 10, Chapter 14, Srimad Bhagavatam. He says, Prapanche nishprapanchopi vidambhayasi bhutale prapanna janatanando shandoham pratitum prabho. Brahmaji tells Krishna, why do you come in this world, my lord? Vidambhayasi. Oh, it is very, very bewildering. Tat atyanta vidambanam. Oh, I am really confused and bewildered as to why do you have to come in this world? Nishprapancha. Prapanchat avatarati iti avatara. Nishprapanchat prapanche avatarati iti avatara. Srila Sridhar Swami describes an avatar is he who descends from the spiritual world into this material world. Although he doesn't have to, he still comes. Now why does he come? Prapanna janata ananda shandoham pratitum prabho. Brahmaji is saying, my lord, you come in this world for only one purpose. Only one purpose. What is that one purpose? Those personality in this world who have surrendered to you and those who are doing bhajan for your satisfaction, only to have reciprocation of love with them, you decide to give up your abode and come in this world of Martya Loka. A sane man who is walking on the street, who may not be very rich, he is just sane. Logically, intellectually, he is just sane. He will never ever ever jump into an open gutter or sewage tank. Never. Because he will think about the repercussion of doing so. If there is an ant which is dying or floating in a sewage, a sane man will still think twice whether it is worth jumping into it and spoiling his clothes and just to save one ant out of it. But the Supreme Lord, who is the richest, who is the most intelligent, most beautiful, all famous, all renounced, all powerful, he jumps into the most disgusting sewage tank of repeated birth and death, only to reciprocate with those pure devotees who, while being in this world, perform Hari Kirtan, Hari Katha and Hari Bhajan, Vaishnav Seva, for his pleasure. Only to give them hope and have loving reciprocation, heartfelt reciprocation, spiritual transcendental reciprocation, the Supreme Lord comes in this world. He doesn't have to, but he still comes on his own accord, Swechha, own desire. This is again confirmed in Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, Chapter 33, Text 36. Anugrahaya bhaktanam manusham dehamastitah bhajate tadrishi kridaya shrutva tatparo bhavet. Srila Shukdev Goswami describes, why does the Supreme Lord come in this world? Anugrahaya bhaktanam. He comes for anugraha. He comes for showering his mercy, bhaktanam, anugrahaya bhaktanam. He comes in this world only to shower his grace, his mercy, his transcendental compassion on his devotees. Interestingly, the word anugraha can be broken as anu plus graha. Anu means anukul and graha means planetary position. You see, we are so perplexed about our astrological charts. What is going to happen next? Is my Rahu and Ketu, is my Shani properly situated? How is my Brihaspati looking? How is my Guru looking? Which Lagna, which Nakshatra, which Muhurta, What is going to happen? Am I going to be under the influence of Sade Sati or 7.5 years of Saturn's influence and so on and so forth? But interestingly, those who serve the Supreme Lord with sincerity, the Supreme Lord showers anugraha. Anugraha means His grace. And His grace, anugraha, means anukul graha. All the planets on our astrological chart will become favorable by serving Hari. So by serving Him, we get His anugraha, His favor, His glance, His mercy. And by His grace, His glance, His mercy, all the grahas, all the planetary positions in our astrological chart become anukul, favorable. This is why He comes. Anugrahaya bhaktanam. He comes for dealing with His devotees, for reciprocating with His devotees. Now when Shri Krishna appeared in this world, in Dwapar Yuga, Shri Krishna appeared in the middle of the night. He appeared in a prison cell in Mathura when there was profuse rain and there were floods and there was no one around. Actually speaking, Shri Krishna could have chosen, as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, to appear during the most crowded, the most populated, the most quote-unquote auspicious time where everyone is around Him. He could have appeared during daytime in a palace of a big king's kingdom. He could have appeared in a very royal, prestigious setup. But Supreme Shri Krishna, supremely merciful, Adbhuta Karunya, Adbhuta Madhurya, Adbhuta Audharya, most magnanimously wonderful Shri Krishna decided to appear in the middle of the night in the prison house to Devaki and Vasudev. Why? Astrologically speaking, that time was very inauspicious. But Shukadev Goswami says, Kalaha Paramashohanam. Oh, the time when Shri Krishna appeared, it was supremely auspicious. Oh, where is the auspiciousness coming from? Astrologically, there is no auspiciousness. But because the Supreme Lord is coming here to shower anugraha on Devaki and Vasudev, all the graha which were actually inauspicious have become anukul. And now therefore, Shukadev Goswami says, Kalaha Paramashohanam. Krishna is appearing. Why at night? Because at night there is no sunshine. There is no ray of light. And it's a prison house where you cannot escape. And most importantly, Devaki and Vasudev are crying their heart out to get Krishna. Krishna is showing us this principle. When you have no ray of hope or light apart from Me, when you are completely convinced that you are stuck in this prison house of repeated birth and death, and when you cry torrents of tears with your heart completely swelling in separation, that is the place where I come for anugraha, to shower My mercy on My devotees. So therefore the Supreme Lord comes for this purpose, for adan pradan, for reciprocation with His pure devotees. Those who are suffering in this world doing Hari Bhajan, the Supreme Lord appears to give them hope that you are doing Hari Bhajan for Me. You think I can sit in Vaikuntha just sleeping on Anantashesh? I have come just for you. You see, when we have Kirtan Melas and so many different public programs, 5,000 of us, 10,000 of us, 15,000 of us, we are all chanting the holy name and dancing. How many of us are able to see Sakshat Darshan of Shri Krishna? But here is a 5-year-old child, Prahlad, who is suffering in this world. And for him, the Supreme Lord comes. Stambe sabayam na mrigam na manusham. He is coming in a form that was never seen before, even by the creator Brahma. Without worrying about how he is going to look. You see, when we go for a public event, shabbily dressed, people may or may not observe, but after a day or two, no one cares. But every single flick of the wrist of the Supreme Lord is recorded by the Vedas forever. Sadhus, eternal pure Vaishnavas, are ready to sing it for the rest of their life. Dhyana avasthita tad gatena manasa pashyanti yam yoginah. Sadhus are seeing this form. And the Samaveda is singing the glories of this form. So the Supreme Lord, without worrying about how He is looking, half man, half lion incarnation, without worrying about what he is going to wear, what kind of garland he is going to wear, where is he going to sit, what kind of drink he is going to have, welcome drink. Instead of drinking water, he is drinking blood. Instead of sitting on a Raj Simhasan, he is adjusting in the same throne of Hiranyakashipu. Instead of being garlanded by Vaijayanti Mala of Tulasi, Mandara, Kunda, Parijata and Kamala, he is taking intestines of the body and garlanding himself just for a 5-year-old child. Our Shachinandan Gaurahari would hear this pastime 108 times. And we have the audacity of saying that I know this pastime. Dhruva Maharaj is in the middle of the forest. 6 months. He is crying and weeping and doing Hari Bhajan. Supreme Lord appears for him. So the Supreme Lord is appearing. Anugrahaya Bhaktanam. That is why he comes. He doesn't come for anything else. And bhajate tadrishi krida yashrutva tatparo bhavet. And he performs such beautiful pastimes with those devotees, hearing which others can take inspiration and purify their hearts. This is why the Supreme Lord comes. How merciful. How merciful. Now the Supreme Lord is taking different incarnations in different times. Prahlad Maharaj is saying, Canto 7, Chapter 9, Text 38, Ittam Rittiryag Rishi Deva Jashavatarayhi Lokan Vibhavayasi Hamsi Jagat Pratipan. He says, my Lord, you appear in different incarnations. Nri, you sometimes come as human. Tiryag, you sometimes come as an animal form. Rishi, sometimes you come as a sage. Deva, sometimes you come as a demigod. Jasha, sometimes you come as an aquatic. Avatar, you are ready to appear in any form. And my Lord, Prahlad Maharaj continues. Then he says, my Lord, not just that. You don't stop there. Channam Kalau, in the age of Kali Yuga, where you are not supposed to incarnate, it is so abominable. Material existence is horrible. In that, Kali Yuga is the most horrible time in the horrible place. And because you are Triyugi, you have some standard, my Lord. You are not expected to come. Still you come. Channa Kalau. You still come in Kali Yuga in a hidden incarnation. You understand that people in Kali Yuga are so hypocritic. They have one face inside and one face outside. So Krishna, yayatha mam prapadyante. Those who have one face inside and one face outside, to catch them, the Supreme Lord is also agreeing to come in one face inside and one face outside. Antar Krishna Bahir Gaura. You are Krishna inside, but you are transcendentally trying to cheat them. You are a transcendental hypocrite, my Lord. Inside you are Bhagavan, but externally you are hiding that identity and coming as a devotee, Prahlad Maharaj is saying. Because people are duplicitous in Kali, you are trying to attract them. Okay, you like duplicity, I will come in duplicity. If I come as Bhagavan, that will be as it is. As Krishna, I have spoken as it is. Bhagavad Gita as it is. I have spoken it as it is. But in Kali, people are having multiple faces. 7 billion people, 14 billion faces. So because everyone is having two faces, Srila Jiva Goswami explains, Krishna is also coming in two faces. Radha Bhav and Krishna Swarup, coming as Gauravatar. And how merciful this Shachinandan Gaurahari is. Supremely merciful. Now, this example is given by great Vaishnavas that I have heard from. That if there is a kingdom, and a very illustrious king rules over that kingdom, he will try to make sure that everyone in his kingdom is happy and well protected. But even if someone starts crying across the river, which is not technically his kingdom, this king will not cross the river into somebody else's kingdom to see why the citizen of that kingdom is crying. The king will just maintain that people in his kingdom, his territory, are all happy. That is his jurisdiction, that is his responsibility. He will not go out of the way, cross the river, go into another kingdom and see who is crying, why are they crying, what do they want and how to make them happy. He will not think. But how merciful our Sachinandan Gaurahari is. He is not crossing the river and going into another kingdom of the same land. He is crossing the Viraja river and coming into this material world because we are crying. He is the king of Shvetadvip, Navadvip, Goloka, Vrindavan. But he is ready to cross the river and come into this kingdom of Maya Devi. Only because now in his kingdom everybody is happy. But this supremely wonderful, magnanimous Gaurahari, Gaura Nataraj, this king is crossing the Viraja river and coming into this material world just to remove the suffering of the citizens of the kingdom of Kali Yuga in this material world. Also, if there is a PhD professor from Harvard or MIT, you give him a challenging task which is worth his academic qualification or his teaching experience, and you give him proper befitting salary, still he will complain about that job. He's a professor with lot of experience and lot of academic publications, and you give him very wonderful salary, still he will find something to complain about. Now imagine if you take that PhD professor and you bring him to some village, let's say Bihar or Uttar Pradesh in India, and you employ him in a school to teach ABCD, and you don't give him a salary, will he come? Oh, he will think this is a big insult. You don't know who I am. How dare you treat me like this? And he's just another PhD scholar at MIT or Harvard who's a professor who's going to retire in some time, temporary position. But Sri Krishna, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, oh, he is the supreme PhD. He is the supreme professor. A professor from MIT takes offense when you call him to the village in India and tell him to teach in some rural school without pay. And the supreme teacher, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who's actually swimming in the ocean of prema, comes into the rural village of Kali to teach Sharanagati, which is ABCD. He's practically teaching how to surrender. Krishna has said, Sarva Dharman Parityajya Mamekam Sharanam Braja. So he's a teacher, very, very erudite scholar, 700 verses of Gita in 40 minutes. It's not a joke. And now he's coming, giving up his eternal abode. He's coming into the rural village of Kali Yuga. And instead of teaching the intricacies of prema, he's starting with practically walking Sharanagati, which is ABCD. And what is the salary? Mukhe Hari Bol Bhai Ei Matra Bhiksha Chai. Oh, I don't need any salary. Bolo Krishna, Bhajo Krishna, Koro Krishna Siksha, Prabhu Agyaye Bhai Mage Ei Bhiksha. The only thing he's begging is that we start chanting the holy name. So merciful. Inconceivably merciful. Inconceivably merciful. In the 8th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, we have the famous pastime of Gajendra Moksha. Now Gajendra in his past life was Maharaj Indradyumna, King Indradyumna. Very exalted personality. And he was sporting in the Trikuta mountains and somehow came to sport in the pond. And as we know, the fortunate crocodile caught hold of the lotus feet of Gajendra Mahashaya. And what did Gajendra do? He offered Sanskrit prayers. Sriman Narayana didn't come before that. Gajendra offered Sanskrit prayers. And he offered a flower. He offered tears. He surrendered. Oh, after he surrendered, Sri Narayana approached. First surrender, then he came. And when he came, after Gajendra chanted his prayers, after he offered the flower, after he cried, after he completely surrendered, Then Sriman Narayana, Mahavishnu, he liberated him. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he is not coming waiting for someone to offer Sanskrit prayers. We are more fallen than the animalistic Gajendra. Because Gajendra was a very fortunate Mahabhagavat in his past life. But we are Kali Chelas. We are Kali Chelas. Mathe Tilak Kantimala Ache Piche Sundar Bala. We are having Mathe Tilak and Kantimala. Very nice Tilak and Kanti. And very attractive bordered dhoti and kurta. And nice selfies. This is what we are. Very nice show bottle business. Gajendra was at least, as an animal, he was straightforward. He accepted, I am Pashu. Madrik prapanna Pashu paasha. He calls himself Pashu. I am an animal. Madrik, like me. Madrik prapanna, I am surrendering. Pashu, I am an animal. Muktaya, oh my Lord, liberate me. Muktaya bhuri karunaya, oh you have unlimited mercy. And namo alayaya, you are not lazy. I am stuck, you are free. You can liberate me and you are very merciful and you are not lazy, please come. But we are more fallen. We are not as exalted as Gajendra. We are not accepting ourselves to be animals. We are not offering Sanskrit prayers. We are not offering flowers. We are not offering tears. We are not surrendering. And still Chaitanya comes. Here Vishnu of Vaikuntha has so many conditions. What to speak of Radha and Krishna from Golok? And they are coming. It is not that first we have to cry, then Gauranga Mahaprabhu will uplift. Chaitanya nitai nahi eishava vichar. Naam le prem de vahe ashrudhar. Oh, Chaitanya nitai nahi eishava vichar. They don't have these considerations. Naam le, just by chanting their names, prem de, they give prema. And vahe ashrudhar. And then because of that, there will be tears. So they are coming even before Sharanagati. And Mahavishnu, when he came, he didn't get his associates. He came alone. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came with his whole Gaur Parshad, Gaur Mandala. Gaurangera Shangi Gane Nitta Shiddha Valimane. Narottam Das Thakur says, all the associates of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu are Nitya Siddha Parshads, are eternal associates of Radha and Krishna. Gauranga Mahaprabhu is sending associates before him, during him, after him, and continues. Our Guru Varga is in Gaur Lila. Gauranga Mahaprabhu is sending our Guru Varga. Srila Prabhupada is in Gaur Lila. Narottam Das Thakur is in Gaur Lila. Vishwanath Chakravarti is in Gaur Lila. Bhakti Vinod Thakur is in Gaur Lila. Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur is in Gaur Lila. Srila Prabhupada is in Gaur Lila. Our Gurudev is in Gaur Lila. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has sent Prabhupada and our Gurudev. And which flower did we offer? What Sharanagati did we possess? Where did we cry? And Mahavishnu came alone. Gauranga Mahaprabhu is coming with his associates. And interestingly, Mahavishnu came, but he didn't get Vaikuntha. Gauranga Mahaprabhu still has kept Navdeep Dham in Kali. Thakur Bhakti Vinod Mahashay, he says, Navdeep Dham is such a powerful place. Every place, every tirtha in Kali Yuga will slowly wrap up its potency. Not that the dham reduces in potency, but the dham wraps itself, winds up, seeing the disqualification of people. Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, Navdeep dham opens up like a lotus. The more sinful people in Kali Yuga are, Navdeep dham opens in jubilation. Now we have a bigger recipient and prospect to give Gaur Prem, Gaur Kripa. And Thakur, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he says, Navdeep Dham Mahatmya, on the last day of Kali, Navdeep Dham will be most effulgent. Ready to uplift everyone, one and all. Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, गौरनाम गौरधाम गौर रूप गुण अपराध नाही मानी तारित निपुण दैट दिस गौरनाम गौरांग नाम दिस गौरांग धाम नवदीप धाम गौरांग रूप गौरनिताई मूर्ति एंड गौर लीला चैतन्य चरितामृत चैतन्य भागवत अपराध नाही मानी दे डोंट कंसिडर अवर ऑफेंसेस एंड तारिते निपुण ओ दे आर कंप्लीटली एक्सपर्ट इन डिलीवरिंग अस प्रेमे मत्त नित्यानंद कृपा अवतार उत्तम अदम किचु न करे विचार जय आगे पड़े तार करे उद्धार अवर परम दयाल नित्यानंद प्रभु इज सो वंडरफुली मर्सीफुल प्रेमे मत्त ओ ही इज इंटॉक्सिकेटेड विद लव ऑफ गॉड इट कृपा अवतार ही इज एन इनकार्नेशन ऑफ मर्सी उत्तम हाई क्लास अधम लो क्लास न करे विचार ही हैज नो कंसिडरेशन वेदर समवन इज हाई क्लास और लो क्लास पात्र अपात्र न देखे न देखे स्थान अस्थान जे जहां पाए तहां करे प्रेमदान पात्र अपात्र क्वालिफिकेशन डिस्क्वालिफिकेशन स्थान अस्थान प्रॉपर प्लेस इम्प्रॉपर प्लेस न देखे गौरांग एंड नित्यानंद डोंट सी ऑल दिस कृष्ण एंड बलराम सी यस दे वर्क ऑन जस्टिस राम एंड लक्ष्मण वर्क ऑन जस्टिस महाविष्णु एंड अनंत शेष वर्क ऑन जस्टिस बट गौरांग एंड नित्यानंद दे वर्क ऑन मर्सी मर्सी मीन्स वेन वी डोंट डिजर्व इट एंड वी स्टिल गेट इट जस्टिस मीन्स वी डिजर्व इट एंड वी गेट इट वॉट इज द बिग डील But mercy means we don't deserve and we don't desire and we are still given. Mahavishnu, when he came to save Gajendra, he gave him liberation. That's all. After crying. But Mahaprabhu is coming and embracing and glancing and giving Krishna prema. So therefore, there is no incarnation like Shashinandan Gaurahari. Wonderfully merciful. Supremely kind. Therefore, our acharyas have described that if anyone takes shelter of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, for sure they will cross the ocean of material existence. Srila Jagannath Das Babaji Maharaj, the Siksha Guru of Thakur Bhaktivinod, he says, you should worship the king in whose kingdom you reside. You should be chaste to that king. So if you are living in the in the kingdom called Treta, you worship your king called Ram. If you are living in the kingdom called Dwapar, you worship Krishna. But if you are living in the most fortunate golden kingdom of Kali Yuga, oh, then you should worship Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. By worshipping Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, all incarnations are included in Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Therefore, one is completely protected. One receives everything. Therefore, it is a big fortune that has touched our lives. Big fortune has fallen on our laps. That we, after bahunam janmanam ante, after millions and millions of transmigrations, we have got human form. Labdhva sudurlabham idam bahusambhavante, manushyam arthadam anityam apiha dhira, turnam yateta na patet anumrityu yavat. Nihishreyasaya vishayam khalu sarvatasyat. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 9, Text 29, Bhagavatam. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur would weep chanting this verse. That how many lifetimes jivas have taken to get this human form. And in that human form, we have developed Shraddha. We have developed some faith. We are not Nastik. If we were Nastik, oh, we have lost this human boat. We are asthavan, shraddhavan jana hai, bhakti adhikari, uttama madhyama kanishta shraddha anusari. We have some shraddha, some faith. But interestingly, it is not towards demigods. It is towards Bhagavan. Most of them who have human form are atheistic. Very few have faith. And those who have faith, most of them have faith for demigods. We are fortunate to have faith for Bhagavan. Now for those who have faith in Bhagavan, most of them think that Bhagavan is Nirakar Brahma. Impersonal, which means no name, no form, no qualities, no pastime. Just merge into him. Tallin. Very few are on the right path of personalism, understanding the Lord has a beautiful form. Sashanka chakram sakirita kundalam sapita vastram sarasiru hekshanam sahara vakshasthala shobikaustubam. So beautifully Vishnu Sahasranam describes what the Supreme Lord holds, what the Supreme Lord wears. So very fortunate people worship Vishnu. But those who have greater fortune, they will worship the root. Bhagavan, Shri Krishna. Keshavadrita, Meena Sharira. Keshavadrita, Narahari Rupa. That killer of Keshi, Krishna. Now among those who worship Krishna, most of them worship Dwarkadish in Dwarka, or they worship Krishna in Mathura. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, Aradhyo Bhagavan Vrajeshatanayas Taddhama Vrindavanam. Quoting from Chaitanya Matta Manjusha of Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, that the most aradhyata, most worshipable form of the Supreme Lord is Krishna in Vrindavan. Now those who worship Krishna in Vrindavan, very rarely are those who worship Radha and Krishna in Madhurya Prem. And there are still who worship Radha and Krishna in Madhurya Prem, the most fortunate worship Shashi Nandan Gaurahari. The beautiful culmination of Radha and Krishna Prem. And we have got human form, have got faith, are not worshipping demigods, we are worshipping Bhagavan, and not Nirakar, we are having proper personalistic viewpoint, and then we are worshipping Radha and Krishna in Vrindavan, culminating as Panchatattva in Navadvip. Srila Prabhupada has forcefully, out of his compassion, given this down our throat, although we didn't desire or deserve. So therefore, these 20 days that we have before Gaur Purnima, we have to understand our good fortune. This good fortune has is arisen in our life. Do we want to just talk, gossip, joke and waste our life? Smeran bhangi traya parichitas Sachi Vistirana Drishti Vamshi Nyasta Ujjwala Chandrakena Govindakhyam Haritanumiha Keshi Tirthopakante Ma Prishtas Yaditava Sakhe Bandhu Sangesti Yangaha. Rupa Goswami is saying that, oh dear sadhaka, if you want to just waste your time being happy with your family and relatives and friends, cutting jokes, then I have just one request. Please don't go to the banks of the Yamuna at Keshi Ghat and look at Smera, the smiling, bhangi, bent, threefold bending form, Sachi Vistirana Drishti, sidelong glance, and Vamshi Nyastha. He has a vamshi where adar kishalayam ujjwalam chandrakena. This threefold bending form of Krishna with a peacock feather and flute resting on his lips can charm your heart to such an extent. I fear, O sadhaka, you may lose taste to be happy in this world. This is a sarcastic way of saying, you fool, run to Keshi Ghat. Give up all your agendas and run. So therefore, we have no other purpose but to do Gaur Bhajan, worship Panchatattva. Right. Today, on the 28th of February, 44 years ago, 1975, in Atlanta, the same city that we are sitting here, the most merciful, empowered Senapati Bhakta of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Srila Prabhupada, came here to Atlanta on this day, 44 years ago, and wept crying, Parama Karuna Pahu Dui Jana Nitai Gaura Chandra. Srila Prabhupada said, these two, Chaitanya and Nityananda, are wonderfully magnanimous. They have appeared only to deliver us. And Prabhupada chokes and breaks down weeping. Please take shelter of them and make your life sublime. So it marks a very wonderful principle that we have started our discussion tonight. And we want to take it every night. being in Vaishnava association, charging each other towards chasing the lotus feet of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Therefore, finally, I just want to say one last verse and then we wrap up. Shri Chaitanya Padam Bhojam Madupebhyo Namo Namaha. Kathanchit Ashrayad Yesham Shwapi Tad Ganda Bhag Bhavet. Srila Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami says, Shri Chaitanya Padam Bhoja, that lotus feet of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is always chased after by nectar seeking honeybees, Madupa, and they are the pure devotees. So the feet of Mahaprabhu is lotus. The nectar in that feet is prema. And chasing that honey, that nectar, are the honeybees called pure devotees. Then Kaviraj Goswami says, Kathanchit ashrayad yesham. Just by taking little shelter of such honeybee like pure devotees, shwa api, even a dog who has no taste for the lotus like feet of Mahaprabhu, tat ganda bhag bhavet, can be touched by the fragrance of that feet, which means the grace of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. The dog which has not gone close to the lotus cannot have the flower, the fragrance of the lotus. But the dog, by taking association of those honeybee-like pure devotees who are chasing the lotus of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's feet, the dog-like, utterly unqualified, undesirous non-devotee can also be touched by the fragrance, by the grace of the lotus of the feet of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Therefore, at 27 years old, I am that dog who has no material or spiritual qualification, no experience, no knowledge, no realization, or any service attitude whatsoever. But many devotees on this call are so experienced materially and spiritually that all of you are Madupa. You are the honeybee like pure devotees chasing the service of honey of the lotus of the feet of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Therefore, offering today's discussion at the lotus feet of all the honey-like pure devotees, I take your permission to briefly stop today, only to continue tomorrow night, where we will continue on this beautiful, wonderful, magnanimous subject of Gaura Tattva. Vancha kalpataru bhyascha kripa sindhu bhya evacha patitanam pavane bhyo vaishnave bhyo namo namaha. As I wrap up, I want to seek the blessings of all the assembled Vaishnavas and Vaishnavis. If I said something which was not in proper line of Siddhanta, as Saragrahi, essence-seeking Vaishnavas, you may kindly forgive me. Please kindly pray and bless so that I may be able to speak in line with Hari Guru and Vaishnava. And if any aspect of today's discussion has motivated any one of us, I offer all of that appreciation at the lotus feet of my most wonderfully magnanimous spiritual master, Om Vishnupad Sri Srimad Radha Govinda Maharaj, and all the wonderful disciples of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Pancha Tattva Ki Jai, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai, Gaur Premanande Hari Hari Bhur.
Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.